there's only one bottom line on Wall Street, and that bottom line is how much money you make.
You've got to be smart, you've got to be quick. If you see something, you've got to act upon it. So much opportunity, and you've got to have the edge.
I love my job. We're always bumping and pushing and shoving and shouting at each other. But at the end of this day, we're still comrades in arms.
Greed is ugly. Make as much money as you can so that you can get out of there before it turns you to the dark side.
This means buy. Let's sell. My name is John Hanneman, and I'm a commodity floor broker at the COMEX division of the New York Mercantile Exchange. That means I can trade base metals, copper, alloy. I can trade gold, silver, options. Over there, they're trading right now. Cotton is open. They trade cocoa. They trade sugar, coffee, orange juice. And what you see here down this row is all metals. Silver, gold, copper. This is what I call my home and my office. The phones and I have in that booth. Some of them go to Paris, some of them go to London. Many of them go to Chicago. I do business for scrap dealers, hedge funds, hedge traders, individuals. It's a broad audience that we do business for here. And once you pass the copper ring, now you go to the gold ring, which is the what we call the fifth currency in the world, which is very sensitive to the value of the dollar. Further on, you have the silver market, which is more of a commercial market than the gold market. I've been a member since 1970. I'm probably the oldest active commodity floor broker in New York.
My name is Shanaz Hussain and I'm a trader. I'm originally from London and I'm 31 years old. I trade the shats on the Eurex exchange, and I've been doing that for approximately 7 years.
For Shanaz to focus on the shats, a specific type of German fixed income security, there's a reason there. It's to sort of hone all the forces you can muster in on one specific security and becoming the expert on how that thing moves, because it's moving all day.
The prime reason I got into finance was the money. I have a goal where I say this is how much money I'd like to make every year, and then I'll break it down to monthly, weekly, and daily. I don't try and trade out of my reach. I say, okay, this is what I'm capable of doing. I'm an independent trader, which means I trade my own money. Since I've been trading on my own, I've done pretty well. My returns are pretty high. Unbelievably high. There is a lot of luck involved. Sometimes I'll just go in and make money literally just like then. I'm like, what did I do? It just happened. But you've got to be smart, because I click trade, so you've got to be able to change your mind very quickly, because that's how the markets react to you. If you see something, you've got to act upon it there and then. You've got to remember there are a lot of other people out there doing the same thing as you. You've got to have the edge.
Hey, how's it going? Oh, things are all right. You know, trading is chugging along, but yeah. I mean, things are going well. It's just gonna take a few months to turn around. Yeah. No, we do have this one position that's losing money. It really is a great company, and even though it is down quite a bit off its highs, I mean, the market is complete shite lately. Yeah. No, I really believe the fund has a great future here. It's really all upside from here. Yeah. It's really not as bad as it seems. I know the stock is down, but it's meaningless right now until you see some results. I definitely wouldn't suggest selling right now. Yeah. No, I understand. Okay. Yeah. I'll email it. Yeah, it's in PDF, just sign it and fax it back to me. That'll be your 30 days notice. You can take it back at any time. You know, I like your money, I like you. All right, I'll email you the form. Okay, bye.
I'm having lunch today with a group of top-notch portfolio managers. They meet on a regular basis to discuss the markets, and I want to ask them their opinions on which qualities to look for in the very best managers.
In this business, 5% of investors know what they're doing, 10% follow the 5%, and 85% have an extremely difficult time.
What do you think are the most important qualities that an individual portfolio manager must have?
It's fortitude and patience, because there's going to be times where you have to be patient, let things play out, and then you have the ability to take a lot of pain.
Perfect your style. You can make money as a day trader, you can make money as a momentum player, you can make money as a deep value player. You just got to stay with your strengths. I think that's very important.
One of the characteristics that a good money manager needs is an evaluation of management. You have to psychologically understand them and understand their strategy. My favorite companies are those that have bad balance sheets with absolutely crackerjack management. By my analysis, that's where you really make the money, especially when people don't believe them and they trade them down to pennies. You buy it when nobody else wants it, and then all of a sudden you have on your hands a stock which is up, can go up 100, 200, 500 times. Now, they're not easy to find, but the micro cap, the small cap area, that's where the real value is, in my opinion. And I see 250 to 300 CEOs a year that I visit with. You need a contrarian flavor to your thinking process. When everybody says it's bad, that's the time to look at them.
I request that we have dessert.
Very interesting.
He's gonna get his money out. And that sucks. The fund is down about 300 grand this month alone, which is what has got all the investors flipping out because of this position that I took. One time I went long for a while, and this is the price I'm paying. He's a $250,000 investor, so he's a pretty large investor. And it happens, you know. I've lost investors before. God, he hasn't even lost any money. He's just lost confidence. This is Wall Street. Wall Street is about perception. When you're down this much in 1 month, why trust a 25-year-old working out of his apartment?
Naked Short. It may sound pornographic. What it actually refers to is when you sell short a security that you have not properly borrowed. Hence, when you sold it, you were naked. Naked short.
I'm an independent floor broker. I trade copper. One contract to copper is 25,000 pounds. And every time I do a trade, I have to transcribe that on a trading pad with the time, within a minute. That card will be picked up by these people with the yellow jackets down here, and also key punched by my employees who entered into a matching system to make sure we don't have any errors. So everybody knows within 15 minutes the financial integrity of the trade. We're always bumping and pushing and shoving. It gets quite heated. We have very stringent rules on physical altercations here. A couple of weeks ago, we had somebody choking somebody else, and we had them both removed from the floor until we found out, you know, who was the culprit and what caused it. And he'll be very heavily fined. I mean, we're yelling and we're shouting at each other. But at the end of this day, we're still comrades in arms. I mean, it's like family. I would consider this my family.
I'm here waiting for this guy. He raises money for hedge funds, and hopefully he likes my fund enough to raise money for me. Everybody wants the millions, but it's a question of, are you gonna get them? Are you worthy of getting any money? Most people think you need a big time office and big time employees and big time technology. And I've proven over the past few years that all you need is a little talent, a little luck, and a little philosophy. But I gotta make my case and tell him what I do and make him believe I am worthy.
In manager selection, what do you think I should be looking for?
An independent intellect is what's most important, not a follower. I had a Chinese fellow in the other day, and I wanted to see what this fellow's really made of, you know? And the Chinese are inscrutable.
you don't really get that answer just by looking him in the face, right? So I attacked him with an aggressive approach on certain touchy subjects and the economy in China. He got all upset and excited, and I found out what he was made of. And I bought the stock, of course, for my clients. A very sharp, excellent businessman who knows his stuff. And I wouldn't have never found that out just by asking mundane questions without insulting him. But that's what's important, to understand the man. What is this man the right man to do the job? You have to be able to discern what is real information and what is just puff.
I'm not going to trade today. I'm going to attend a seminar. It's called Derivatives World.
I'm on my own, so it's important for me to keep up to date with what's going on outside, who my competitors are.
I want to catch up with one of the executive board members of the Yorks Exchange. He'll be able to answer some of my questions that I have with regards to the product I trade and the service providers that I use, and I know them personally, so I'll meet up with them.
So electronic trading, this is what it's all about.
The cool thing is that they recalculate, it's asked to change the different parameters.
It's a man's world. It definitely is a man's world. It's funny, sometimes I'm out and, you know, just to make myself feel comfortable, and I know I shouldn't have to do this, I mean, you know, I'm not afraid, but at times I just tell people I'm a secretary or a PA because people feel more comfortable talking to me. But then I'll be like, okay, I'm gonna tell you what I really do, and it's, people just switch off. It's like they don't know how to talk to me. I've had comments like people say to me, oh, I've been talking down to you. You know, they'll say things like that, and I'll say to myself, that's a real stupid thing to say. Like, you're talking down to me, big deal. Just talk to me like a person. Back in 2001, a lot of people made money very easily. The markets were very good. Now, there are a lot more players, definitely. I mean, at one point, I was anywhere from 10 to 15% of the volume of that particular contract. Now, I'm lucky if I'm 1%. I've had bad days where I've lost money, where the average person here in the United States would not probably make for 5 years.
So tell me about your strategy.
My strategy, it's short bias. You know, I'm shorting small cap and micro cap stocks just when they run up. You know, there's a lot of manipulation in the micro cap and small cap area. A lot of hype, a lot of retail euphoria. A lot of people get emails and text messages and phone calls the night before saying, oh, buy this stock, it's going up. And they see it going up and they buy the stock. And I look for these inefficiencies to short into these fundamentally flawed companies. It's very unsophisticated, the marketplace that I deal in.
I'm going to see Jim Rogers. He's one of the legendary investors of our times, and he started the Quantum Fund with George Soros in 1973, and for the remainder of the decade, they had an unbelievable return of 4,000%.
Let's go.
Thank you. Wow. This is certainly an entrance. Wow.
Thank you.
This is unique. I've never seen this in New York.
All of this stuff comes from my travels from various places around the world.
You started the legendary Quantum Fund with George Soros in the early 70s and did that for 10 years. Why did you stop doing that? Why did you quit?
One reason I quit was because I didn't want to wake up at age 75 and they would say Rogers was a great investor. That's all he ever did, though. I mean, I wanted to buy my freedom and have the freedom to pursue adventure. So I did a lot of traveling. I motorcycled around the world. Done a couple of those trips, and then the car trip around the world. You know, we were held hostage. We went through epidemics. We went through wars, blizzards, and deserts. This was not a trip to Atlantic City for the weekend.
You did what most people dream about doing, but they could never afford it, and they could never do it.
The last leg of our trip, in fact, we were coming down from Alaska. We were in Palo Alto, and a guy came running over to us and said, oh my God, this is my dream. He's about 45 years old. He said, I've always wanted to do this, and now you've inspired me. I'm going to do it too. Then he looked at the car, and he said, well, that's a two-seater, isn't it? He said, yeah. He said, you mean 3 years side by side in a two-seater? You were never apart? We said, yeah. He said, my fiance and I set out to drive from Connecticut to California, and we hate each other. He said, we've never spoken to each other since. He said, that bitch got out in Denver, and I didn't even slow down.
how long would it take for you to develop ideas or put money to work? Someone wants to invest $5 or $10 or $20 million.
I mean, you wire me the money, I could have it in my brokerage account next day.
But you'll have the ideas to put it to work.
The ideas are always there.
I mean, they're deep enough.
Yeah, I mean, the ideas are there pretty much every few days.
Who have you targeted? Who your investor base?
I need rich individuals.
Yeah.
That's what I needed, and they're the hardest.
Well, you need sponsorship. Most of the people I meet are long biased.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you're the other extreme, and it's refreshing. We may have people that fit.
Oh, I appreciate it.
Great.
It was good meeting you, though.
Thanks for coming. You too.
Thank you. I think I got some money from him. I don't know. We'll see. He has my materials. He's talked to me on the phone before. He didn't remember, but this time he saw me in person. Made my case. He seemed pretty interested. It could be BS, but I don't know. He's got access to so much capital. All I need is just a little bit of that. Just give me a little access, a little bit, a little taste of his money, you know. And I'm pretty damn happy right now. You know, I'm walking down the street. Everyone can sense I'm happy. So look at them. They're all looking at me. Why is he so happy? Why is he so happy? I'm happy. I am. So.
You ain't a celebrity.
I'm a celebrity in a bit. I just got $1 million.
September 16th, 1920. It was a bustling morning on the exchange. Just before noon, a horse-drawn wagon pulled to a stop right here on the corner of Wall Street and Broad. Moments later, the wagon blew sky high. The massive explosion killed 40 and ripped into the House of Morgan. You can still see the gouges in the limestone facade.
It is like in a movie.
This is the secret door.
What do you think is the one thing that made you so successful?
I guess it's probably just being skeptical and curious and inquisitive about what's going on in the world, and the willingness or the eagerness to look at things that other people don't look at. If something is very cheap, by definition, people probably are not very interested in it, and nobody's investing in it. And frequently, that's where you find your best opportunities, if there's a change taking place. You don't do it just because nobody's investing there. Commodities was a perfect example. The end of 1998, everybody giggled when you said commodities or China. They were all drooling and talking about dot-com. Well, I was looking at commodities in China because I thought that's maybe where things were changing and where there were opportunities. So happens it was right.
So how do you see China's future?
Extremely bullish on the future of China, yes. The 19th century was the century of the UK. The 20th century was the century of the US. The 21st century is going to be the century of China, whether we like it or not.
Usually I'm in here 1 hour and 10 minutes before the opening, so I can see what's going on in the financial industry and the rest of the world. We can no longer look domestically at the US. World events have placed a question mark on the stability of the US dollar and the stability of the Western nations. NYMEX is the largest physical commodity market in the world. I mean, it's just not trading copper. You're trading dollars, you're trading different currencies. Energy has an impact on it. The stock market has an impact on it. And I have a broad array of markets to look at. You have to utilize all those tools. Right now, the demand for copper has been astronomical, not so much from the US or Europe, but from the Far East. The growth of China, the growth of India, 2.5 billion people living in a part of the world that was third world. Right now, everything that China and India produces, most of it goes to exports. You gotta think though, what's gonna happen when they become the consuming nation? When they start consuming their own products, what happens to the raw goods then? Will there be enough copper in the world? Will there be enough zinc and lead and tin in the world? I mean, this is what makes commodity trading so interesting. This is why every day it's a different ballgame. It's never the same.
Are you Muslim?
Yeah.
Assalamu alaikum.
Where are you from?
London originally, but I'm Pakistani. Sometimes when they hear my accent, they think I'm new and they'll take me around the whole block and run up the meter. And then if they're like either Pakistani or Indian, then it's like, oh, you must know so-and-so in London because I'm related to him. Either that or they'll try and get me married to one of the sons and we're like, you know, I have a son. He looks around your age.
How far do you want to go?
This is perfect. I love New York. I've always believed that the city's paved with gold. So much opportunity, and it's up to you to grab it. I feel like I was very sheltered when I moved in. For me personally, I've grown, definitely, and I've met fantastic people here. My mother just about has got to grips with what I do. When I first started, she's like, you know, when you've made a bit of money, you should just leave. Don't get too greedy. You know, that will change you as a person. And she's right.
So this is gonna be my new neighborhood. I just signed a lease the other day for a small apartment, an old townhouse built in 1899. I'm looking forward to it because this is definitely a transition for me. Not so much late night partying, more just focus on the business. You know, I'm not really fitting into the corporate structure of investors because they have their little check boxes and, oh, he's under 40. Psh, there goes my chance at getting money. Everything. Total period in my life. It's kind of crazy. Yeah, successes and failures. But the key is that I keep learning. You know, I'm 25 years old. If I don't make a lot of money for the next 2 or 3 years, but I learn a lot, it's still a win. I could do this for the next 50 years. Great, thank you. I will. I'm pretty optimistic about my future. My organization's so lean, there's not a sense of urgency like there is for most hedge fund managers who have their employees, salaries, you know, the big office. I can wait out times when there's really not many opportunities. I need to keep finding connections, keep building the track record. And I'm getting smarter, a little richer, a little fatter every single day. So not to be a cliche, but the future really does look bright.
After a lot of serious consideration, I have decided to leave my company that I've been with for 5 years. There are just so many things that I would like to do, so many ideas that I have that I would like to put into practice, that I have decided to go out on my own. Pretty much everything is in place. Essentially, what I'll be doing is primarily raising capital for clients, and I think it should all work out very well. Wall Street has been a very enriching experience for me. I feel that I had the opportunity to grow a lot, and I'm very excited to see what the future holds. I just generally try to be happy, approach everything with a positive attitude. I think that's also one of the prerequisites for Wall Street. Make the most out of the opportunities that you have.
I did the jig last time. You only get one jig per episode.
I tend to swear at times. Bollocks! Mother something I actually learned here.
The guy who has the best tan wins in life. Not the guy who has the most toys wins. The guy who has the best tan wins.
Oh my. Ah, financial muscles, baby.